Strong tower.
Hallelujah.
He's our refuge. He's our strength. He's our life. And we celebrate his love towards us. We celebrate his faithfulness towards us. We celebrate his message towards us. We bless him for preserving our lives. And we bless him for every good thing that is done. Every blessing that is bestowed upon us. And we welcome viewers across the nations. This Liberty House International Church coming to you live all the way from the U.S. via Facebook and YouTube. In case you miss any portion of the broadcast, please go to our webpage, libertyhouseusa.org. Once again, libertyhouseusa.org. Or you can go to our YouTube channel, type in our full name, Liberty House International Church. And there you go. You're going to have videos that will pop up. And then you can treat yourself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We are learning so much. Folks may not be aware of it because I'm not selling books. Some of the things that I share, I can just put in the book form and sell and make money. But I'm not doing that. And because probably I'm not selling them, some people don't see the value of it. But this is very, 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 very valuable. And I want you to take advantage of it. So we thank you for studying alongside us, and I'm here. My mission is to push you forward, is to advance the cause of the kingdom, and not to put anybody down. It's not to be condescending or demeaning to you, to degrade you. No, I'm not here to offend you. So if anything comes up that it looks like, it sounds like, it seems like, please don't take it that way. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm ministering to you in love. And I'm a messenger of the Lord Jesus Christ, an agent of change and transformation, always with the message of transformation. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And we've been studying about spiritual growth for some time now. There's the need for the spiritual person, or every born-again person, every believer of the Lord Jesus Christ, to grow. Hallelujah. And I'm taking it from all angles because I don't want to title this part one, part two, part three. It can become boring. So I use different kind of titles, and I don't even call them subtitles, but we are still dealing with the same thing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. So Sunday we shared something that was transforming. We're talking about the fact that we are dead to the law. Now, why do I emphasize these things? Your growth in the Lord Jesus Christ somehow is contingent on you understanding this subject of the law, the rule of the law, and the rule of the law now. Whether the law is still in effect, whether it's powerful, whether it's you have to obey it, you have to depend on it, you have to rely on it, or you take some portions of it to do and some portions you don't obey. You know, this is a huge kind of controversial kind of subject in the body of Christ. And listening to a lot of preachers, listening to some of the sermons and some of the things that people share with me, I have there's a burden. I have a serious concern in this area. I see the deception. In some cases, I will call it demonstration of lack of knowledge. In some cases, just people using that because that is what the people like. And then so they keep doing that. Whichever way, I want people to see the light. I want people to come out of bondage. So I want to share the truth. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus said, you know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So we are dead to the law. We are married to Christ, according to Romans 7:4. We are dead to the law, but we are married to Christ. And when we say the law, we are referring to the whole Naiad, the Ten Commandments, and the ceremonial laws, the whole thing, the Mosaic, the Judaism, whatever. All right. Then also, the Bible says Christ is the end of the law, according to Romans 10:4. Christ is the end of the law. And the way to please God is no longer contingent on one's obedience to the laws, the Ten Commandments, and what have you, but is based on faith in Christ Jesus. Now, the Bible says that whoever wants to live by the law and stumbles in one is guilty of the whole law. That is James 2:10. If you stumble over one, you break one law, you are guilty of all. And to me, that's a hard thing to do. James 2:10. Nobody has been able to do it before. So that's why Jesus Christ, he fulfilled the law. So we don't have to deal with that. So all that we do is our faith, our trust in him. Tonight, I'll attempt to share something still under this debt of the law that will help you. Hallelujah. Okay, so for whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. That is James 2:10. So if you choose to live under the law too, the Bible says you're under a curse. Those who choose to live under the law, they're under a curse. I think it's the same place that talks about that, the book of James. All right, let not be tempted to go there. So somebody will say, okay, I'm getting tempted. Let me leave you alone. Let me talk about what I'm going to share today. Hallelujah. Do we need the law? If you're a believer, do you need the law? The Ten Commandments and all the attaches. The Ten Commandments and all the, it's garnishment. The Ten Commandments and all what else? Dessert, if you want to call it that way. Hallelujah. Do we need it? And we are going to go through the Bible and see if we need it. But I'll tell you the answer right away. We have no need of the law. We have no need of the law. And for the person who said, what are you saying? Just be patient and let's study together. So let's go to, for studies, Galatians chapter 3. We'll take verses 24 and 25. Galatians 3, verses 24 and 25. Galatians 3, verses 24 and 25. I'm looking for something down here. Okay, I got it. I read, therefore the law was our tutor. All right, schoolmaster. That's what it said in the traditional King James. Okay, therefore the law was our tutor. Okay, T-U-T-O-R. To bring us to Christ, that we might be what? Justified by faith. Let's finish this and then we'll go to the Old King James. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. Let's go back to the 24. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster, to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. So I want to say this. If God wants us all to stay under the law, to be obedient to the law, there will not be any need for all this faith issue, faith subject, or Jesus Christ showing up. Alright? But after faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. After faith has come, we are what? No longer under a schoolmaster. And a schoolmaster means this. I'm telling you what the Greek says. A boy leader. A servant whose charge or office it was to take the children to school. By implication, a tutor. Like how the New King James says it. And then it's used only in these two verses, the whole Bible, these two verses. Schoolmaster, referring to the law. All right, now let's look at the New Living Translation. We'll take 24 and 25. So if a schoolmaster is one who is a leader, who is to take a servant whose office or job charge is to take the children to school, where is he taking them? Someplace. And here the Bible makes it plain. He's taking us to what? Christ. The law was taking people to Christ. That's how simple it is. Okay. Now let's read, what do we have? New Living Translation. One second, I'm trying to pull something off here. I don't know if that will work, but I'll try it anyway. Okay. This is... It says, schoolmaster, the guardian. I'm reading my word and notes here. The guardian responsible for care and discipline. The guardian responsible for care and discipline. All right? That is one of the side notes in the Bible. The guardian responsible for care and discipline. So we can say here that the law was the guardian responsible for care and what? Discipline. Okay. Now let's have the read a New Living Translation. I read. Let me put it another way. The law was our guardian, correct, until Christ came. It protected us until we could be made what? Right with God through faith. This is so simple. To me, people who miss it, okay, this is no downer. It's like, which part of this English is not clear? Do you all agree with me? Yeah. This is so clear. So why do people wrestle with this? Is it because they like the law and they want to obey it? No, what Bible says about the law is bondage. And I'm going to take you there for you to see it. It's bondage. Okay. And it says that, and now, if he says now, then there was what? Then. Something before. So before, now is now. And now that the way of faith has come, we no longer what? Need the law as our guardian. Isn't that simple? We no longer need the law as our guardian. But then people say, what? Moses got this thing. 40 days he was on the mount. God himself, it was written on, it was the finger of God. And he wrote it and all that. Okay, I get it. But what about God himself showing up in human form? In human flesh? And coming down? That one, the stones, which is more powerful? The finger of God and God himself, which is better. You got what I'm saying? But this is how people look at it. You know, it's this, it's that, and people have held on to these things for years, and the confusion is coming from this. But today, I want to do it. I want to do some good. So that was before Christ. Before Christ refers to Old Testament. BC, before Christ. Old Testament. And now we are in the year of our Lord. We are still in 2021. This is the last Friday in the month of July. All right. So we no longer need, or we are no longer under, I want to say that again. We are no longer under a schoolmaster. The days of being under a schoolmaster are over. I want to say that again. The days of being under a schoolmaster are over. That's what the Bible says. I'm not saying it. We no longer need the law. Why? Because God has shifted gears. He's into something else. The law kept us till what? Faith came in. Or the law kept us unto Jesus. Let me go further and see if I can do this. Let's look at a verse. Let's go to chapter 5, verse 1. The same Galatians, chapter 5, verse 1. So Christ has truly set us what? Free. Now, make sure. This is what I always close the broadcast with. Now, make sure that you stay free and don't get what? Tied up again in slavery to what? The law. That's how simple it is. Don't get tied up. Don't get tied up again. Don't get tied up again. Don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. It refers to the law as slavery. It refers to it as bondage. Now, when you read Acts chapter 15, a similar thing was when some people came into the body and they were saying that the Gentiles who have been born again, they need to be circumcised and other blah, blah, blah. They were told, no. Why are you trying to bring some kind of yoke upon them? The law is referred to as yoke. When you read 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 and 9, the Bible says that it's the ministry of death and it's the ministry of condemnation. Why do we want to come under the ministry of death and the ministry of condemnation? Why? Ignorance. That's plain simple. It's due to what? Ignorance. It's due to misinformation. Just like the same thing is going on about the coronavirus vaccine. Misinformation. And everybody is saying, those who are no authorities are saying whatever they are saying. So why? So Christ has truly set us free. It's now your responsibility. Now make sure your responsibility that you stay free and don't get what? Tied up again in slavery to the law. Now, if somebody should say this, Paul qualifies to say that he was then Saul. And he became Paul. Saul was so entrenched, he was so profound, very deep in the law. He persecuted the church, or those who were followers of Jesus Christ, till they had a revelation of who Jesus Christ is. And this guy wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. He has such revelation of grace, of this new way apart from the law. And so he shares all these things. So if we are reading this, we are reading it from somebody who is qualified. And he was talking to the Galatians, the church at Galatia. Do you get it? Yeah. So we easily go there. We are talking about the Mosaic Judaism. See, you can't take one. Let me see if I can do this. Let's go back to chapter 3 that we're reading. And look at verse 26. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. He didn't say the law. Under the law, nobody was called a son of God. It's only Jesus, the firstborn. Jesus is the firstborn son of God. And by virtue of our faith or anybody's faith in him, he also becomes a son of God. That's why in John chapter 1 verse 12, the Bible says, as many as received him, Jesus, they were given the authority, the privilege, the right to become sons of God. So when the Bible refers to me as firstborn, because he's not the only son of God, we have all become sons of God by our faith in him. So he's referred to as the firstborn. We are all joint, we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. The Lord didn't do this for us. If the Lord didn't do this for us, we should not go back to the law. And I've heard this argument. Some people say, no, you can't throw away the New Testament. That is where they go wrong. Nobody is saying throw away the, Old Testament. They say you can't throw away the Old Testament. The Bible is whole, both the new and the old. Nobody is saying throw away the Old Testament. Come into present truth. Amen. Certain things are no longer valid. They are obsolete. God no longer, cherishes. God no longer accepts those things, just like the animal sacrifices. It's in the Bible. So if you like, you to go rear, you know, animals and kill them every day. Kill one, you know, so God will be pleased with you. No, he doesn't accept that anymore. It doesn't matter how many times you wash your feet. It doesn't matter how many times you wash inside your ears. That is not what makes you acceptable before God. Because I know in some religions, that's what they do. What makes you acceptable before God, right standing before God, is your faith in Christ Jesus. Period. Nothing else. Now, not even fasting makes you acceptable before God. It's your faith in Jesus Christ. Not even your prayer makes you acceptable. It's your faith in Jesus Christ. I don't want this thing to be twisted. The Bible doesn't say, whoever prays this number of days, whoever prays this number of hours, then he can become a son of God. No. The Bible doesn't say, whoever fasts for this number of days, then he becomes a son of God. Or I'm going to be pleased with you when you fast. Now, why am I saying this? This is where people get tied up into slavery to the law. Because they go back to the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, that was one of the ways. To me, I'll say even the major way for you to be for God to be pleased with you. You put on sackcloth, you repent, you fast for God to see that, you know, you mean business, you have you are repentant and all that. In the New Testament, we go to God on the basis of the blood of Jesus Christ, on the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So people who are now trying to fast, they are sacrificing for nothing. You see, we call that human effort because God accepts Jesus Christ and not your fast. And I'm going to go back because of what things I'm going to say that are so dangerous. Dangerous in the sense that it's not popular. I'm going to say this again. When Jesus in Matthew 7:7 says, ask and it shall be given. He didn't say ask with fasting and it shall be given. So how come man has added fasting to what Jesus said? The same folks who say that you shouldn't take away from the Bible and you shouldn't add to it. But here they are adding to it. You see, the people who are going with the law, they are not really dead to the law. They are still married to the law. We as believers, we are dead to the law. We are married to Christ, according to Romans 7:4. So Jesus says, ask and it shall be given. Simple. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Period. There's no fasting either. So who added the fasting? Man. Not God. Tradition, not God. Ignorance, not God. Self-effort, not God. Law, not God. Because fasting was introduced in the law. I was sharing with this with a minister of the gospel. The minister said, wow, the light came on. I don't say these things to belittle people, but I want you to understand when I say that ministers, they are quoting the Bible, they are sharing the word, but some are not into present truth. I want you to understand that. I started talking about the fact that Abraham was blessed by God without fasting. He was blessed by God without prayer. He was blessed by God without any kind of sacrifice of giving. God himself decided, okay, Abraham, leave your what, country, your father's house, your people, to a place that I'll show you. And the Bible calls that faith. Abraham left, he departed in Genesis 12. When it comes to Hebrews 11, 8, the Bible says, by faith, Abraham left or obeyed God when he told him to leave. That's faith. God spoke, he acted on it. There was no fasting. The blessing that came upon him and came upon his son Isaac and came upon their grandchild Jacob or Israel, there was no fasting involved. There was no prayer involved. God decided to do that. Hallelujah. Now I want us to understand that. Now, this same blessing came all the way into the New Testament in Galatians chapter 3. And the Bible says this, and we are going to read it. Hallelujah. You see, it came by promise, not by law. Hallelujah. So where is it? Where is it? We are going to go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 16. No, let me start with 16, please. Sorry for that. Is that 16?
Yeah.
Confirm. No, let's go back to 15. 15, yeah. Brethren, I speak in the manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant, yet if it is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it. Do we all understand? In fact, change to the New Living Translation. Hallelujah. So we read kind of modern English. All right, I read. Dear brothers and sisters, here is an example from everyday life. So we are talking about naturally what we go through society. Just as no one can set aside or amend an irrevocable agreement, so it is in this case. What case? He's talking about this promise that God made to Abraham. So we started talking about God bless Abraham from Genesis 12. That time there was no law. And you are going to see that there was no law. That's why Sunday I was asking, Moses and Abraham, who is older? Somebody said Moses. And I said, that's where the problem is. You know, you have to know your stuff well. I was just kidding. Okay, let's move on. But Abraham was before Moses. Let's read on. The next verse. God gave the promises to Abraham. Take note of this. He gave the promises to Abraham. Okay, let's read it this way. He gave the law to Moses. Two of us. He gave the law. But with Abraham, before Moses was even born, he gave the promises to Abraham and his child, the child Isaac. And notice that the scripture doesn't say to his children, plural, as if it meant many descendants. Rather, it says to his child. And that, of course, means Christ. Isaac, in typology, is a type or a shadow of Jesus Christ. That is why God asked Abraham in Genesis 22, sacrifice your son Isaac, the one that you love, your only son that you love, sacrifice him. And he took Isaac to the altar. He was about to sacrifice him. And the Lord held his head. And then provided, the animal. Now, that was a type of Jesus that would be sacrificed. The only son. Now, somebody will say, but there was Ishmael in the picture. No, when we come to Galatians, you still know that Ishmael was human effort. It was the law, human effort. It wasn't a child of promise, because Isaac was the one that was promised to Abraham and then Sarah. All right? So God worked with Isaac. Okay, so the seed refers to Jesus Christ. All right. Okay, let's read on. Remember, promises and the seed. This is what I'm trying to say. The agreement God made with Abraham could not be canceled 430 years later when God gave the law to Moses. Where is Moses coming into the picture? God would be what? Breaking his promise. I'll take it again. This is what I'm saying, or I'm trying to say. The agreement God made with, or the promise God gave to Abraham, could not be canceled 430 years later when God gave the law to Moses. God would be what? Breaking his promise. So we can say this way. The promise that God made to Abraham stands even today. The law did not affect it. Bible is saying it. The law did not cancel it. Now, I'm going to read another version so we get it clear. And then I'll continue. So let's have amplified version. Somebody will help me to read that one. Okay, let's try it. Let's all read together. Read. This is my argument. The law, listen to this, says what? The law, which began 430 years after what? After what? After what? The covenant. After the covenant. What covenant is God referring, or the Bible referring to? The covenant he made with what? Abraham. The covenant he made with Abraham. The law came into the picture 430 years. There was no fasting. Those who fast and claim that God, I'm fasting so you bless me, is ignorance. If you are born again and you are a child of God, I'm going to prove it to you right now before I move on to whatever I'm sharing today. If you are a child of God, your union in Christ Jesus brings you to a place of blessing. Amen. The blessing of Abraham is conferred upon you. Amen. And it's in the same book, Galatians chapter 3, 13. Oh my goodness. The law could not cancel it. Now, I want you to think. The law doesn't have enough power when it comes to the promise, the covenant that God made with Abraham. The covenant is so powerful. The covenant, another word for that covenant is the blessing, is powerful. Another word is the inheritance. So you can use covenant, you can use blessing, you can use inheritance. What God gave Abraham, promised Abraham, is that powerful. To the point that the law that people are still trying to hold on to, that, oh, this was special. You know, and the finger of God wrote this on tablets and blah, blah, blah. You know, did not nullify, did not erase, did not eliminate, did not annul, did not cancel the promise, the covenant, or the inheritance that God gave to Abraham. It is still in effect today. And I'm going to show you that. Hallelujah. So it says, I'll read it again. I love it. This is my argument. The law, which began 430 years after the covenant, concerning the coming what? Messiah. Talking about Jesus Christ. Does not and cannot. Oh, I love it. Does not and cannot annul the covenant previously established, while ratified by God, so as to abolish the promise. No way. And make it void. It's impossible. You know why? Do you know why? It was established in Christ. Hallelujah to Jesus. Let's have a message. This was 17, right? Message says, this is the way I interpret this. A will. Well, somebody has to die, and they leave you a will, right? If they like you. If they don't like you, there's nothing they will for you. But God so loves us, so he left us a will. This is the way I interpret this. A will, earlier ratified by God, is not annulled by an addendum attached 430 years later, whereby negating the promise of the will. No way. Now let's continue. Why? There's something powerful that I want us to realize. Because it was done, it was confirmed. Let's have the New King James. This is what I've been saying all the time. You see, faith is nothing new. It started with Abraham. How do I know? Because Hebrews 11, it says, by faith Abraham obeyed God. Referring to Genesis 12. When God told him to go. Referring to Genesis 12. Alright, so faith has been assistance. Just that it was what? Confirmed in Christ, and it was sealed in his death. That's all. Alright? And these are saved that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before God in Christ. In Christ. That is key. Alright, let's continue. Verse 18. What purpose then? Okay, we are reading New King James, right? Where am I? 18? Oh, I was on 19, forgive me. For if the inheritance, is it what I was talking to you about? Covenant, promise, inheritance, blessing, saying, hallelujah. For if the inheritance, for if the blessing, for if the covenant, for if what? What's that other thing? Did I mention all? I'll start again. How many did I say? For if the inheritance, if the promises, if the, no, I said inheritance first. So if the inheritance, if the promises, if the covenant, if the blessing, all right, is of the law, it is no longer of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by what? Promise. You see, that's no law. It's not by law. That's why when I say people, when they go back to Deuteronomy chapter 28, and says, if you hearken to my voice, and then be careful to observe all that I've said, and obey all these commandments. And the commandments even are not mentioned there. So people even don't know what commandments they are dealing with. See, the moment you go there, why? I know why you go there. Because you are interested in, and these blessings shall follow you. You see? Oh, Lord have mercy. That was then under a schoolmaster, under the law, before Christ, Old Testament. Alright? That kept us, that served us, and brought us to Christ. But now that Christ has come, we have no need of that guardian, that schoolmaster. We have no need of law. Because what happened? In faith, or through faith in Jesus Christ, the blessing, the inheritance, the covenant, the what? What's the other word? For. You should be saying it with me. Come on, I'll start again. The inheritance, the promises, the covenant, the blessing. Good. That's what I'm talking about. You see, I repeat stuff intentionally because it has to sink. Hallelujah. Because people get confused. They said, oh, you know, I'm not blessed. And the people go and say, I want God to bless me. Well, if God should bless me, have you heard me say something like that before? At least learn from me. You're already blessed. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And these people, they sing, Abraham's blessings are mine. You see, people do stuff for doing sake. I don't think they have understanding to it. Hallelujah. He gave it to him by what? Promise. Not the law. Hallelujah. Before I read 19, I want to tackle this. Go to verse 13. We'll come to 19, but let's look at 13. Oh. Wow. Let me back up. Jesus. We read already, James 2:10. That says something powerful. If you stumble in one of the laws, you're guilty of all. Now, let's start from verse 10, Galatians 3. Galatians 3 from 10. We'll come to the 13. Hallelujah. Let's read together. Read. For as many as are under the works of the law are under the curse. What curse is he referring to? The works that come under disobedience to the law. That's simple. And if you want to know that, go read Deuteronomy chapter 28. When you start from the 14th verse, you are going to see all the way to verse 66 or so. Curses. If you break one of the law. Wow. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. So that's why some people are struggling. It's like it's raining. You're out there, no shelter, no umbrella. Somebody offers you an umbrella. They say, oh, I'm cute, I'm fine. And then you are drenched, you know, in the rain. And you see, and now you begin to, you know, vibrate. I mean, you are shaking because you are cold. And you are still saying, I'm cute and I'm fine. That is what is happening to some believers. You see, because they like, how should I say? Come on. They like this thing about, I'm doing something for God to be pleased by it. God shows us how he wants to be pleased. And that's what we have to do. Period. Hallelujah. Amen. We think God is like a man that we can do something to get his attention. There's a way to get God's attention. It's faith in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It says, if you ask anything according to my will, I'll hear you. I'll do it. That's how simple it is. Because why? Christ has died for you. So let's finish this. Cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. So this is where some believers are. Those who want to go back into slavery, tied up in slavery to the law, bondage. All right? Let's read on. Hallelujah to Jesus. But that no one is justified by what? The law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Okay, people's argument is this. We don't have to obey the law to be saved. But after we are saved, we have to go back to the law. This is stupidity in its highest form. The thing that has no power to give you the right status before God, to give you right standing before God, for God to be pleased with you and for you to become acceptable to him. He couldn't do that. Something else does it. Then you say, I'm going back to the thing that couldn't save me or the thing that couldn't plead my case before God and live by it. If it's not foolishness, then I don't know what it is. The just shall live by faith. That's what it is. Let's read on. 12. You see, as I'm talking to you now, somebody probably is in the book of Psalms and praying, Lord, teach us to number our days. Teach us, search me, O God, and know my heart. And yesterday I was telling you, I recorded a prayer. It's on my phone. The person was standing, you know, and praying. And the power and the energy, and was asking God, God, I'm asking you to protect me. God, I'm asking you to bless me. God, I'm asking you to guide us. This foolishness. You know why? It's no prayer. It's man's effort, man's work, lack of understanding. Why do I say that? The Bible says he's giving us his Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Then he's shouting, Father, I'm asking, just like you did, so I'm asking you to guide us, you know, by your Spirit. But he said, I've given you my Spirit to guide you. So you're asking him to guide you. How does he do it? Give you another Spirit? You have to know the Spirit that is given to you, the guidance is in that Spirit. That Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. So your prayer should be, Father, I thank you for giving me your Holy Spirit, or giving me the Holy Spirit to guide me into all truth. That's how you pray. Okay, so you pray this also. I'm asking you, you know, that you protect me, God. And then the reason why I started recording was this. We are before you and we're asking you for grace. Father, we're asking you for grace. So we'll serve you according to your will. Like David served you according to what? Your purpose in his generation. So when somebody is loud this way and they are throwing their hands and they are, you know, then people think, wow, that guy. No, that's ignorance in demonstration. You see, listen to this. Why would you ask God for grace so you serve him? God won't ask you to serve him if he hasn't given you grace to serve him. I will say this very well. It's just like God will not ask you to love your neighbor as yourself if you are incapable. All right? If you are incapable of loving, God will say love. But God gave you love. So he says to love your neighbor. Because he's giving you love, he says, oh, love your enemy. Because he knows he's wired you, he's made you able to do that. So to pray to God and say, God, I'm asking you to give me love, is a wrong prayer. But this is what is going on. And some pastors are doing that. They are encouraging that. Hallelujah. So for somebody to say, give us grace so we'll serve you. Oh, I mean, so pathetic. It saddens me that somebody is standing before God and say, and the way the strength. And I said, what? Is this guy talking to God or who? The way, God, I'm asking you. God, you know, make us. God won't make you to do anything. He wants you to choose. He wants you to know his word and choose. So God, make us. God, make us do. God. No. So to me, I call that religious calisthenics. We do that kind of exercise and we feel good. Wow. Today I prayed. Your emotions were all over the place into it. But it's no prayer. Give us grace. When you have grace, instead of, I wonder how God feels. He's going to tap you on the shoulder. Son, I'm giving you grace. Why don't you appreciate the grace? Like Jesus said, where are the nine? Because 10 lepers were ministered to. Only one returned. So where are the nine? So it's like, I've given you grace. And you're asking me for grace? Why don't you thank me for the grace that I've given to you to serve me? But this is what is going on in the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. We talk about grace. We're talking about divine enablement. We talk about grace. We are talking about the blessing. When we talk about grace, we can use the word inheritance. When we talk about grace, we can talk about covenant. You see, by virtue of our union with Jesus Christ, all these things are ours. That's why it's easy. It's so easy to serve God. If one chooses to serve God, I'm telling you it's easy. Because you're not going to do it by your strength. But people get tired because they do it by their strength. And at times, our serving God, it's like, oh, we are trying to do God a favor. Or if I don't show up, you know, so and so would think so. And if this, you know, that's what it's become like. But it's not like, oh, I want to do this because I understand the magnitude of his love, his sacrifice towards me. And then, okay, this is the best thing I can do is to worship him. Hallelujah. Amen. Paul says, yet the law is not of faith. So why do people mix it? The law is not of faith. So people say they are of faith and then they go to the law. You know this especially when people are praying. Look, I have the tape here. I don't want to play it. But I've been going through this, talking to people. That's one of the things that I've been doing behind the scenes. One-on-one talking to people, and especially ministers of the gospel, talking to them. They'll be all about, they'll say, you know, and I'll wait. You know, the Bible says this, the Bible says that. And you know, the Bible says that, and I'll wait. I'm very patient. They'll say everything that they need to say. And then I'll just come in with the present truth. Okay, the same verse I'm talking about, in the same word order. The Bible says this, the Bible says that. And then it's like, okay, they will push it. And then I'll come again, debunk it with some present truth, and then they'll say, okay, okay. Now the light is on. You see, they've done this for years. It's like, it's difficult for them to accept it that it's wrong. You get what I'm saying? I'll tell you one, for instance. I dealt with this person, fasting is concerned. Then he said, no. You see, if you teach what you are teaching, then, you know, you have to teach it this way. Let people know that fasting is one of the Christian disciplines. I said, no, I'm not teaching that. When I'm teaching about the fact that you need to believe God for what he has said, I'm not going to add fasting to it. Because Christ himself didn't add fasting to it. God didn't tell me to add fasting to it. Unless you go to the Old Testament. In the New Testament, there's no fasting. And then we're talking about just this. It doesn't take fasting to do the works of God. Because in John chapter 14, verse 12, Jesus said, whoever believes in me, the works that I do, shall he do in greater word. And if people know the word, it's simple. There, he didn't say that for those who are able to fast 21 days. This go down again. I was talking to somebody, and the person said they fasted even 70 days. My heart aches when I hear some of these things, I'm telling you. And what they are going through, it doesn't take 70 days. It doesn't even take one day fasting to take care of it. But this is what is going on. And I said, no. Jesus said, if you believe in me, the works that I do. So who is saying you have to fast before? Who is saying that? Where did it come from? So why do we have difficulty in accepting the fact that, hey, you can live right before God, you can be pleasing unto God, you can do everything acceptable to God according to his word. And you don't have to fast. When I say according to his word, I'm not saying going back under the law. We are under grace. We are not under the law. We are not under the schoolmaster anymore. Now that faith has come. Unless these people, they haven't accepted faith. That's what it is. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, let's read on. Where are we now? Verse 12. Yet the law is not of faith. But the man who does them shall live by them. Meanwhile, nobody has been able to do that. All right? Now 13 and 14. This is the heavy part. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. If the law is good, why would he not leave us there and enjoy the law and enjoy all the curses that the law comes with? But he has redeemed us, having become a curse for us, for it is written, curse everyone who what? Hangs on a tree. What is the reason? 14. Now let's go for it. That the blessing. Do you see it? That the blessing. That the what? Covenant. That the inheritance. That the promise of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. In the law. In Christ Jesus. That we might receive the promise of the Spirit, not the law. The promise of the Spirit through faith, not the law. Now, let's flip this in different translations. Let's start with New Living Translation. I like doing that because it brings it out. Some people say when they read the Bible, they don't understand. Shall we read together? Okay, let's try that again. Let's read. Through Christ Jesus, God has blessed what the Gentiles with the same blessing he promised to Abraham. Let's read. But this is how I read the Bible. When I read, I just don't read to come out and say that, oh, I read the whole chapter of Galatians chapter 3. That's not how I read the Bible. When I read, just one verse becomes even like a study. And I may not be able to finish within a specific period of time, finish that verse. Because there's so much in there that leads me into other areas and becomes a study. All right? So I just don't read. Then I meet someone and I said, have you had your quiet time? Oh, me, today, my quiet time, I read Galatians chapter 3, the whole chapter. Then you are feeling good. And you don't even remember. You don't even remember what you read. No. So it says, through Christ Jesus, not through the law, not through Moses. Let's not forget that. Not through Moses, but through Christ Jesus, what? God has blessed the Gentiles with the same, that's a key thing, same blessing he promised to Abraham. Did you get it? Started with Genesis 12. It hasn't changed. Because it said, in you shall all the families of the earth be blessed, so that we who are believers might receive the promise, Holy Spirit, through faith. Do you get it? That's how simple this is. So the same thing, Christ's death confirmed and sealed it. That's it. Where is the law now? Has no effect. God even wants, he wants these same Jews to come to know Jesus, to embrace their Messiah, not the law. We read the 15. So let's jump to the 19 that I said I'm not going to read it and save it for later. 19 now. Let's read.
Why then was the law given?
A question. It's going to answer. It was what? Given alongside the promise to show people what? Their sins. The law was given to do what? To show people their sins. So each time you go back to the law, you'll be exposed. You are not able to obey. It shows your weakness. It tells you that you need God in your life. You can't do it by yourself. It's to show people what? Their sins. But the law was what? Designed to what? Last only until the coming of their child, that's Jesus Christ, who was promised. God gave his law through angels to Moses. Do you see? He gave his law through angels to Moses. The law came through Moses, who was the mediator between God and the people. All right? Okay. Let's flip it to let's try Amplify. This is tiny. I need some help. Now a go between or intermediary has to what do with and implies more than one party where or there can be no mediator with just one what person. Yet God is only what one person. And he has what? He was the sole party in giving that promise to Abraham. But the law was what? A contrast between two. A contract or contract? Contract. Okay, let's take that again. But the law was a contract between what? Two. God and Israel. Do you see now? It's what? Its validity was what? Dependent on both. I don't know if people get it. The validity of the law depending on both. God to do his part and Israel to do their part. But when you talk about a new covenant, the one promised to Abraham, this is different. Jesus Christ has done it all, and all we have to do is to believe in his finished works.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, reading this, let's go to John chapter 1. I think I've done justice to the purpose of the law. John chapter 1, let's take from verse 12. John 1, verse 12. Oh, you have it amplified. Okay. And to as many as what? Did receive and welcome him, he gave the authority, power, privilege, right to become the children of God. That is to those who believe in, adhere to, and trust in him and rely on him, rely on his name. Let's change it to King James. My time is almost up now. So this is what I was saying from the beginning. As many as receive him, where they were given the power to become what? Sons of God. Okay, let's continue. 13. If I let me jump so we can finish this week. Okay, let's read. Read. Who were born, and not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Do you understand what you are reading? Do you understand? Okay, let's continue. 14. And the Word became flesh, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and what? Full of what?
Grace.
Full of what?
Grace and
what became flesh?
The
Bible says the Word.
Yeah.
Who is the Word?
Jesus.
Okay, remember that the law came through Moses. The law came through Moses. But here it says what? Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Do you get it? Let's read on. John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. Did you get what we are reading? Okay, let's read on. 16. From his fullness, or of his fullness, we have all received grace for grace. So if he says we have received, does it mean that it's something that we are going to receive in the future?
Yeah.
It means we have.
Yes.
It's in our possession.
Yeah.
All right. What have we received then? Grace.
Yeah.
So is it okay for somebody to say, God, give me grace?
Yeah.
And are we in union with Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
Are we the temple of the Holy Spirit, the temple of God?
Yeah.
Are we one with Christ?
Yeah.
Is it the vine and we are the branches? So you see the foolishness I'm talking about? When people pray for grace, they don't know what they have. That's why they'll pray for grace. I guess, to me, it's a poverty mindset. It's a beggar kind of mindset. Beggar mindset. Always asking. To the point that people don't know even the authority they have over the devil. And this prayer that I've said, I recorded, the guy kept praying and saying, God, I'm asking you, open the windows of heaven. Open the windows of heaven. Rebuke the devourer. Now, the Bible didn't say we should pray and for God to rebuke the devourer. Does it say that? See? Old Testament. If we look at that even context, Malachi 3, it says, when you give your tithe, he, God, will rebuke the devourer. So certain things you don't have to pray. Give the tithe. Give the offering, I will rebuke the devourer. But if you be, you know, God, I'm asking you. I don't know why people like to command God like that. I'm asking you, rebuke the devourer. You know, open the windows. And no, I'm not being, I'm not exaggerating. It was the same way, the way he was throwing his arms about, and the voice, and the pitch, and all that. It was like that. And I'm like, oh, this is simple. Give your time then. Give your offering. If you want the windows of heaven to be open and the devourer to be rebuked, do what he says do. Give your time, give your offering, and then God will take care of whatever. His business. Not so.
Yeah.
But he's standing, rebuke the devourer. Open the windows. Give us grace. You have grace. In the New Testament, we are to rebuke the devil. You don't call on Jesus to rebuke the devil. You have been given authority to rebuke the devil. To rebuke any demon.
Yes.
That's what it is. So you have to be taught that you have the authority. You have delegated authority. You have power over all the powers of the enemy. So you can stop his works. Hallelujah. That's how simple it is. Verse 17. For the law was given through Moses. But grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. That's how simple it is. Moses' time is past. Moses is dead. Jesus said, my Moses, my servant, is dead. Who is alive? Jesus Christ. Who are we to listen? Jesus Christ. He speaks through him now, according to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. That's it. I don't get it. Hallelujah. Bible says love is a full in Romans 13. Let's look at Romans 13:8. Did I read this? Since we're in Galatians, I'm sorry. Since we're in Galatians, let's do this. 2:21. 2:21. Let's read together. Read. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. Let's read the New Living Translation. I'm going to share something here with you. You see, anything that will be pleasing unto God, anything that is going to be acceptable to God, must be done by faith, not by the law. I'll say that again. Anything that is going to be pleasant, pleasing, acceptable to God, is always done by faith. Anything that is done aside of faith is sin, not law. I do not treat the grace of God as meaningless. For if keeping the law could make us right with God, then there was no need for Christ to die. Yep. Isn't that simple? So don't go back to the law. Okay. Now let's read the Romans 8. Did I say Romans 8? What did I say? Okay, thank you. You see, now do you know that Jesus Christ, you know, we are no longer under schoolmaster, but Jesus Christ, he says he's the light of the world. That's according to John 8:12. Jesus is the light of the world. He says, whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So it's not about following Moses anymore. It's not following Jesus. Do you get it? Let's keep this out of there. Let's put the John 8:12 there. John 8:12. Whoever follows Jesus will not walk in darkness, will have the light of life. Okay, Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. In John 14:6, he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Not Moses, not the law. Then again he said in John 16:13, when even I'm not here with you, my spirit will still be with you, and my spirit will guide you. When he, the spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. So the law doesn't teach us anything now. The Holy Spirit is the teacher. Okay? So in Romans 13:8, the Bible says that what? Owe no man anything except to love one another, for he who loves another has fulfilled the law. That's what the Bible says. He who loves another has fulfilled the law. Romans 13, put it there, please. Romans 13:8. All right. Owe nothing to what? Anyone except for your obligation to love one another. If you love your neighbor, you will fulfill the requirements of God's law. Look at verse 10. I'm done. The same thing is in Galatians chapter 5:14. It says love is the fulfillment of the commandment. Love does no wrong toward others. So love fulfills the requirements of God's law. That's why Jesus stressed on loving one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. A new commandment I give unto you. That commandment is to love. All right, so I'm going to end with the words in Galatians chapter 5, verses 1 and 13. Stand firm, the liberty. Well, with Jesus, the anointed one, has made you free, and do not be again entangled with the yoke of bondage, but by love serve one another. Thank you. I love you dearly.